Good morning. I have written as cholesteatoma. Actually, this is a term coined by Johannes Muller, a German physiologist in 1800s. This word is a must for an otolaryngologist, be it a consultant in ENT or a resident or an undergraduate. The term cholesteatoma actually is a misnomer, because this doesn't contain cholesterol, or oma word meaning is tumor. This is not a tumor and it has no cholesterol in it. This cholesteatoma is actually a pocket of squamous epithelium in a place where it is not supposed to be in. So today's class is about cholesteatoma, and I'll explain about the definition of cholesteatoma, which is very important for residents and undergraduates, and the theories of formation of cholesteatoma, then the types of cholesteatoma, the different types, and also the pattern of spread of cholesteatoma, the clinical features, management, which includes investigation and treatment. This is very much important. Definitely you will get either a case scenario or a long essay or a short note on cholesteatoma, and also in your clinical practice you will see, at least in India, you will see at least a dozen in a year, at least a dozen. Telling about a short history, that is, it was coined by a German physiologist called Johannes Muller, and later Virchow defined it as a tumor of mesenchymal cells. Okay. And Politzer, all these names are familiar to otolaryngologists. And Politzer told that it is a tumor of the glandular neoplasm of the middle ear mucosa. And actually the Schuchnert defined it as a keratoma. Okay. And otherwise called a Schuchnert's keratoma. Schuchnert called it as keratoma, which is a better terminology, because actually this cholesteatoma is a mass of keratin debris. In Viva you will be asked, what is the definition of cholesteatoma? So this cholesteatoma is a pocket. Think about a sac. The sac is lined by stratified squamous epithelium. Okay. So this sac lined by stratified squamous epithelium. Okay. On all areas. Right? Stratified squamous epithelium. So it's a sac lined by stratified squamous epithelium containing keratin debris. Okay, inside it also there is keratin debris. So here there is keratin and there is a stratified squamous epithelium matrix, and this rests on a fibrous stroma of varying thickness. Okay, so around it there is a fibrous stroma of varying thickness. The thickness can vary, and this also has got a bone eroding properties. Okay, it has got bone eroding property. So if it is resting on a bone, there is chance that it can erode the bone. How it erode the bone, I will tell you later. So this is the definition of a cholesteatoma. Cholesteatoma is a sac lined by stratified squamous epithelium containing keratin debris resting on a fibrous stroma of varying thickness and having bone eroding property. Okay, so that is a cholesteatoma. Actually it is a collection of stratified squamous epithelium. And why it is important? What is the why we all are telling about cholesteatoma? We are studying about cholesteatoma. Why it is important? For that I'll ask you, what is the lining of the middle ear mucosa? It was explained in my class on anatomy of middle ear. I'll tell it once more here. So, this is your external auditory canal. This is your tympanic membrane. And here comes the middle ear. Malleus, incus, long process, and stapes. Okay. Right. What is this? This is a Eustachian tubal opening on the anterior wall. So, what is the lining? Along the anterior wall and towards the Eustachian tubal area, it is lined by ciliated columnar epithelium because it is the Eustachian tube. It is something related to respiratory epithelium. So, here it is stratified ciliated columnar epithelium, that is respiratory epithelium. And on the medial wall, this is the medial wall, it is more towards a single layer of low cuboidal epithelium. Okay, and in some areas on the hypotympanum, it is with a low columnar epithelium. So, there is predominance of ciliated columnar epithelium, which is of respiratory type, and also there is single layer of low cuboidal to low columnar epithelium. Nowhere there is stratified squamous epithelium. So, this stratified squamous epithelium, if it comes within the middle ear, not only in the middle ear, it can also happen in other areas, in the temporal bone, intratemporal or also extratemporal, especially in areas of petrous apex, then in the CP angle, cerebellopondyle angle, it can happen, especially the congenital cholestasis. So that is why it is important. If there is an intruder is coming to an area, if an intruder is coming to your home, it can cause lot of problems. Like that, if a stratified squamous epithelium pearl or a sac of stratified squamous epithelium coming to an area where it is not supposed to be so, always these intruders are difficult to handle. So here also the same happens. The stratified squamous epithelium is coming to an area where it is not supposed. Along with that, I'll tell you the histology also. According to one concept, it has got a cystic matrix and perimatrix areas. So the central part where the keratin debris are there, it is the cystic content, and the stratified squamous epithelium around, it is a matrix, and this fibrous stroma is considered to be the perimatrix area. And another classification of histology classification is into four layers. The innermost is a basal layer and outermost is a corneal, which is the keratinized squamous epithelium, and in between comes the Malpighian layer and the granular layer, and from the granular layer there is ingrowth of the epithelium into the basal layer also. So histologically there are two classifications according to two theories. Types of cholesteatoma. So what are the types of cholesteatoma? It is divided into congenital and acquired. Acquired again divided into primary acquired and secondary acquired. Some group or some others call a tertiary acquired also, which is caused by implantation or iatrogenic causes, like after putting in ventilation tube or after doing a meningoplasty, especially an overlay meningoplasty, etc. So, congenital and acquired, under acquired, mainly to primary, secondary and a tertiary also. And for each group of, or each class or each type of cholesteatoma, there are theories of formation. Okay, so the next one coming is the theory of formation. So, under type there comes a congenital and acquired. Acquired again divided into primary, secondary and tertiary. And theories of cholesteatoma formation. And in the theories of formation of congenital cholesteatoma, there are so many theories, but the most accepted one is a Tietz epithelial cell rest theory and also Friedberg's implantation theory. At least you have to remember the first one, that is the Tietz epithelial cell rest theory. What is that? During development, there is a derivative of first brachial groove. It remains as an epidermoid plate at the junction of middle ear cleft and the eustachian tube. Okay, so at the junction of the middle ear cleft and the eustachian tube, there is a epidermoid plate which is the derivative of first brachial groove, and usually this has to involute or disappear by 33 weeks of gestation. If it is not resolving, then that get stuck in, that get implanted, or it is remaining inside the middle ear cleft. Then that becomes this congenital cholesteatoma. Not only in the middle ear cleft, but it can also happen intratemporal and also extratemporal sites are there. Intratemporal, the most common site is a middle ear cleft, but it can also happen which all areas? Jugular fossa, then skull base, petrous apex. Okay, petrous apex can happen. And in extratemporal, can happen in jugular fossa, or it can happen in the CP angle. Okay, cerebellopontine angle cholesteatomas can happen. Actually, the cholesteatoma is the third commonest mass seen in CP angle. The first one is an acoustic neuroma, and the second commonest in the CP angle is a meningioma, and the third commonest tumor in a CP angle is a congenital cholesteatoma. So this epithelial cell rest theory, that is the epithelial cells, squamous cells are getting trapped inside the middle ear cleft and also some areas in the temporal bone and also extratemporal areas, and that is the Tietz theory. And this implantation theory is that this amniotic fluid contains squamous epithelium, and they are implanted in some of the areas, especially in the middle ear cleft of the neonates. This is name of Derlake and Clemis criteria for classification of cholesteatoma into congenital cholesteatoma. There are three criteria. One, this is a pearly, there should be a pearly white mass behind an intact tympanic membrane. Okay. There is no white ring. I am putting this as a green color. Actually, this is pearly white. There should be a pearly white mass behind an intact tympanic membrane, and the pars tensa and the pars flaccida should be normal, and there should not be any pre-existing ear infection or ear disease. These three criteria should be there to call it as a congenital cholesteatoma. Okay, so there should be a pearly white mass behind an intact tympanic membrane, the pars tensa and pars flaccida should be intact, and third, there should not be any tympanic membrane perforation or any pre-existing ear infection or history of any pre-existing ear infection. The cholesteatoma caused by retraction of the tympanic membrane due to recurrent secretory otitis media is excluded from congenital cholesteatoma. Canal atresia and intramembranous and giant cholesteatomas are also excluded. So, canal atresia, intramembranous and giant cholesteatoma, and also cholesteatoma seen in an ear with a retracted tympanic membrane due to recurrent secretory otitis media. All the three are excluded from congenital cholesteatoma. Okay, so you have to remember this name also. Regarding the theories of formation of a primary acute cholesteatoma, what happens there? The basic pathology is formation of an eustachian tube obstruction. It starts from here, which lead to chronic middle ear negative pressure. If it is not, it's an acute type, or it is coming and going okay, or happening occasionally, it will not go for a permanent middle ear negative pressure. If it is chronic middle ear negative pressure, there are two chances. One, it can happen, go for a middle ear effusion or a subclinical infection, recurrent attacks. In that case, there is Sathe's theory of metaplasia. What happens there? There is metaplasia of the epithelium within the middle ear cleft into a squamous. So actually it is a squamous metaplasia. Okay. that will go for a primary acute cholesteatoma, or it can lead to proliferation of the basal layers suggested by Lange and Rudy's theory, that again go for a primary acute cholesteatoma, or if there is a retraction pocket, formation of retraction pocket, which is more commonly seen in the attic area because this pars flaccida is lax. So the first there is a retraction pocket, and this retraction pocket later it become more deeper. So first a small retraction pocket, and later what happens, this retraction pocket deepens, and inside the self-cleaning will not happen in that area. So there is chance of debris collecting inside the retraction pocket, and this retraction pocket collection of squamous epithelium. So there will be recurrent infection of the squamous epithelium and also formation of a biofilms. So it enlarges and it causes bone erosion, and also there is chance of a small perforation at the apex of the retraction pocket. And through this squamous epithelium will migrate into the middle ear cleft, forming a primary acute cholesteatoma. That is a theory proposed by Whitmack. Okay, so these are the theories of a primary acute cholesteatoma, that is squamous metaplasia theory by Menden Sade, the proliferation of basal layer by Lange and Rudy, and invagination and invasion theory by Whitmack. Secondary acute cholesteatoma, you have the Habermann's theory. What is that? Actually, what is secondary acute cholesteatoma? Cholesteatoma happening secondary to a tympanic membrane perforation. So in the tympanic membrane, you can see a perforation. So from the external auditory canal, the squamous epithelium of the external auditory canal, or from the superficial layer of the tympanic membrane, will go migrate through this, migrate and invade into the middle ear cleft. Okay, so that is, you think in that way. So migrating through a perforation and invading into the middle ear is the Habermann's theory of secondary acute cholesteatoma, and this is sometimes called a tertiary acute cholesteatoma, or some textbooks tell it under the secondary acute only. Implantation and invasion. What is that? It is an iatrogenic, either because of an overlay meningoplasty or because of putting of ventilation tubes. There is chance of this epithelium from the external auditory canal or from the superficial layer of the tympanic membrane will implanted into the middle ear and causes invading and causing a cholesteatoma. So in primary acute, what is happening? There is invagination, only a retraction pocket, invagination and invasion like this. But here it is migration through the perforation and invasion. And iatrogenic causes implantation and invasion. Of all these theories, the widely accepted and the recent widely accepted one is this combination theory proposed by Sudhoff and Toss, which states that at first there is a retraction pocket formation, which is happening more commonly in the attic and also posterior superior marginal areas. And this retraction pocket, first there is a retraction pocket, and this debris, because of the self-cleaning mechanism is not working properly, the debris will come and collect inside the retraction pocket. So there is this squamous debris will undergo repeated bacterial infection, formation of biofilms. And after that, what happened? It will expand, proliferation of the squamous debris and expansion. Okay. And leading to bone resorption. So, and Toss also staged pars flaccida retraction into four stages. The stage one is, this is pars flaccida, this part. Stage one is, there is formation of a retraction pocket, but this is neck of malleus. Stage 1 is retraction pocket is formed but not in contact with the neck of malleus. See, this is stage 1. Stage 2, in contact. So stage 1, not in contact. Stage 2, retraction pocket in contact with the neck of malleus. Okay. And stage 3, stage 2 plus minimal outer active wall erosion. This is the outer active wall with minimal erosion of the outer active wall. And stage 4 is stage 3 plus drastic erosion of the outer active wall. Okay. So stage 1, TOS staged the pars placida retraction pocket. Stage 1 is minimal retraction pocket is formed. This stage not reaching the neck of malleus. Stage 2 is in contact with the neck of malleus. After that it expands. So that what happened? There is minimal outer active wall erosion, and in stage 4 there is drastic outer active wall erosion. Along with that there is bone resorption also. So the mechanism of bone erosion by cholesteatoma is important. What happens then? What are the mechanisms of bone erosion due to cholesteatoma? One, pressure necrosis. Okay, that is pressure necrosis. What is that? That cholesteatoma will apply pressure on the ossicles. So that constant pressure will cause necrosis. But it is not accepted now. The accepted one is enzymatic theory. Enzymatic theory states that this osteoclast will produce collagenase, cytokines and other proteolytic enzymes. So that it will cause resorption of the bone. And the third cause of bone resorption is because of chronic or repeated infection, there is pyogenic osteitis. And also there is hyperemic decalcification. Okay. Okay, so one is pressure necrosis. Of these, the most accepted one is enzymatic theory. Okay. That is the osteoclast producing enzymes. Which are the enzymes? They are the cytokines, collagenase and other proteolytic enzymes which causes bone erosion. And also pyogenic osteitis because of recurrent infection and also the hyperemic decalcification theory. Because of all these, it causes bone erosion. Erosion of the ossicles, erosion of the scutum, erosion of the tegment plate, erosion of the facial canal, erosion of the labyrinth. And because of that, there is chance of complication, and also the signs and symptoms are related to this property. Another important area is spread of cholesteatoma. So what are the common sites of cholesteatoma? Sixth one is spread. What are the common sites? If you draw a right impairing membrane, this right side. So the commonest location is posterior epitimbanum, this area. This is anterior, this is posterior. Posterior epitimbanum. Then comes the posterior mesotimbanum. Then the third commonest is the anterior epitimbanum. Okay. So the posterior epitimbanum, posterior mesotimbanum and anterior epitimbanum. From there, the cholesteatoma spreads to other areas, to all these areas. And it is determined by mucosal folds and also the compartments. I explained these areas, mucosal folds and compartments of the middle ear in detail in an earlier class. You have to see that before learning this cholesteatoma, because the spread of cholesteatoma, that especially the Broussard space, boundaries of Broussard space, then anterior pouch of von Roche, posterior pouch of von Roche, all these are explained beautifully in a class on mucosal folds and compartments of middle ear. So I am not going to that again. So that is the spread of cholesteatoma. This is the clinical features that include signs and symptoms. So what are the symptoms you can have? In a majority, the patient will be asymptomatic. Okay, especially in the case of congenital cholesteatoma, the child may be asymptomatic. Or what all things can happen? Complaining of. Okay. There will be ear discharge. What are the characters or specific characters of cholesteatoma? Ear discharge. Ear discharge will be scanty. Okay. Only in some time this symptoms will happen. So, ear discharge. Characteristic foul smelling. Okay. And scanty ear discharge, then it is continuous, okay, because this bone eroding property is always there, so there will be continuous discharge and it will be scanty also. Foul smelling, the typical description is fishy smell because of the anaerobic organism, it produces a typical fishy smell, foul smelling. Okay, mucoid or mucopurulent discharge, then sometime it will be associated with bleeding, especially if there is granulation tissue formation, there will be bleeding also. Okay, right, from the discharge itself you can tell that the patient is having an anticoagulant disease or presence of cholesteatoma, because in a tubotibanic disease the discharge will be more copious amount and also intermittent, usually associated with an upper respiratory infection or entry of water into the ear, then there won't be any less chance of bleeding in a case of tubotibanic disease and also less foul smelling, right? So these are the features of an ear discharge of a cholesteatoma. Other features like tinnitus or an oral fullness. Okay, so tinnitus, then fullness in the ear, then slowly progressive facial palsy. Think in terms of complications. So if it is eroding the facial canal, it can cause a facial palsy. Then vertigo, if it is eroding the labyrinth. Okay, especially in the case of congenital cholesteatoma, you get an oral fullness or tinnitus, slowly progressive facial palsy, then hearing loss, slowly progressive hearing loss. Then in case of, if it is a petrous apex cholesteatoma, the main symptom will be a parietal headache. So all these features, these are the symptoms of cholesteatoma. And among symptoms, these are features pointing towards obvious signs, and these need special attention to rule out intracranial complications. So, in a case of, usually in a case of CSOM, whether it is TTD or AAD, the pain will not be there. If there is pain, think of an otitis externa or an extradural abscess or a perisinus abscess. And if there is patient developing vertigo, think in terms of labyrinthitis or cerebellar abscess. And in case of cerebellar abscess, there will be additional ataxia also. And nominal aphasia is pointing towards a temporal bone abscess, temporal lobe abscess, and also the swelling in and around the ear shows an mastoid abscess. Mastoid abscess was already taken previously. So facial weakness shows that there is erosion of facial canal associated with an element facial palsy, and if a listless child with insomnia and anorexia pointing towards an extradural abscess, and if the patient develops headache, nausea and vomiting, think in terms of raised intracranial tension, and if there is fever, irritability and neck rigidity, think of meningitis, and if presenting with diplopia, it is more towards a petrous apicitis, that is Grenier-Leroux syndrome. Petrous apicitis or petrositis was explained in detail in an earlier class. If there is drowsiness, bradycardia, pointing towards brain abscess. So all these symptoms should raise the suspicion of development of complication, especially in the case of cholesteatoma. and on examination, that is by ear examination or by otoscopy or by otoendoscopy, what will you see there? Again, right side. So this is right ear, and in cholesteatoma, you can see either an atique perforation, or there will be atique retraction pocket, or there will be posterior superior retraction pocket, or marginal perforations. Okay. So usually we draw the. This will be a perforation, and the retraction pocket is drawn as dotted lines. Okay. Usually we represent retraction pocket by dotted line and perforation by complete round. Okay, so there can be an atique perforation, atique retraction pocket, or posterior superior retraction pocket, or marginal perforations. And sometimes you can see the cholesteatoma through the perforation, or inside the retraction pocket you can see cholesteatoma. And sometimes there will be granulation tissue, then oral polyp will be there. And in sometime the fistula test will be positive also. Okay, so these are the common clinical finding. The next is investigation. This presence of cholesteatoma is almost diagnosed during the clinical examination itself using an otoscope, and confirmation is by using otto and microscopy, that is examination under microscope. You get the confirmation of diagnosis mainly to differentiate between a perforation or a retraction pocket. So how will you differentiate between a perforation of tympanic membrane and a retraction pocket? That is, for a perforation you will have margins. Margins can be palpated using a cotton tipped applicator or using a probe. You can palpate the margins, whereas in a retraction pocket these margins cannot be palpated. That is number one. Number two, through the perforation you can see the middle ear, but through a in a case of a retraction pocket the middle ear mucosa cannot be seen. And the third is using a pneumatic otoscopy. The mobility, even if it is diminished, the mobility will be present in case of a retraction pocket, but in a case of perforation the tympanic membrane will not be mobile. These are the three main important differences between a retraction pocket and a perforation. Second, the extent of disease can be determined using an otomicroscopy or examination under microscope, and also the discharge can be taken from the middle ear for culture and sensitivity, and the antibiotic can be changed accordingly. The second is hearing assessment. Mainly the Puritan audiogram and tympanogram. Okay. In a usual case we get a conductive hearing loss, and if it is more than 40 dB it shows that there is ossicular erosion or discontinuity of the ossicle. And even if there is gross necrosis or erosion of the ossicle, sometimes the hearing loss will be minimal. Why it happens? Because the cholesteatoma may bridge the gap. The gap between the ossicle will be bridged by the cholesteatoma. So in that case, the preoperative hearing will be almost normal, and after the surgery, the hearing loss will be more. That has to be written and in the consent, and also it should be explained in detail to the patient also, otherwise there can be chance of medical legal problems. Okay, so that is about hearing assessment. And in coming to the radiology, still there is value for x-ray, mastoid, lateral oblique view, or Long's view. Okay, so x-ray mastoid is still important. X-ray, we take bilateral always, even if the disease on unilateral, even if the disease is on the right side or on the left side, usually we take x-ray mastoid of both sides. and also the commonly taped one is lateral oblique view or Laws view. Okay. In that case, if there is cholesteatoma, we can see a bone erosion with the surrounding areas of sclerosis. Okay. So that is regarding X-ray mastoid and HRCT, high resolution CT scan of the temporal bone with 2 mm cuts, both in axial and coronal cuts has to be taken. In that case, you get a non-dependent homogeneous areas of soft tissue mass along with the bone erosion. That is a typical finding. And where will you get the soft tissue mass? Yeah, especially in case of Prusak space or in the posterior mesotympanum or in the anterior epitympanum. Okay. And if there is a secondary acute cholesteatoma, it will be the soft tissue mass will be mainly in the sinus tympanum, that is medial to the occiput. That has to be remembered. Past tense of cholesteatoma is usually the site of origin is the sinus tympani. In that case, this soft tissue mass will be medial to the occiputaceae. That has to be remembered. Okay. Bone erosion, which is the commonest site of bone erosion, it is the long process of incus. Okay. And also the ingudo-stapedial joint erosion. That is the most common site of bone erosion is the long process of incus. Okay, or the incus as such. Because this long process of incus has got endarterial blood supply, it is eroded most commonly. Okay, so these are the finding, and also this MRI can be taken, and MRI is complementary to HRCT temporal bone. And this HRCT temporal bone is taken when we are planning for a mastoid exploration along with the ossicular reconstruction. That is number one indication. And secondly, if we are suspecting any complications due to cholesteatoma, then also we have to go for an HRCT temporal bone, which is mandatory. What is the treatment of cholesteatoma? So the treatment of cholesteatoma is surgery. There is no medical treatment. Okay. So it is surgery, and the aim of surgery is to make a safe, dry hearing ear. Okay, so this is the goal of our surgery. Conservative management can be tried only in cases where the patient is critically ill, that is unfit for surgery, or when patient is not willing for surgery, or in any condition where the benefit are less than, or the complication or the risk of surgery outweighs the benefit of surgery. Okay, and also in cases of the canal is very wide, external artery canal is very wide, and you can see the fundus of the retraction pocket through which the cholesteatoma can be sucked out, and the patient is willing for coming for a regular follow-up, then also the conservative management of regular suction clearance and oral toileting can be advised. In all other cases, we have to go for surgery. There are canal wall down procedures and canal wall up procedures. That is, the external posterior canal wall is maintained in case of a canal wall up, and this posterior canal wall is drilled out in case of a canal wall down procedure. And regarding this mastoid surgeries and canal wall up and down procedure, it will be dealt in detail in a separate class. So the most common surgery done in a case of cholesteatoma is a modified radical mastoidectomy, which is a canal wall down procedure. Okay, and the type of surgery depend upon the age of the patient, then the extent of cholesteatoma, the eustachian tube function, presence of complications, and the willingness for the patient to come for follow-up. So regarding cholesteatoma, you have to study in detail. I have discussed about the history, the definition, the histology, the types of cholesteatoma, theories regarding cholesteatoma, the spread of cholesteatoma, the clinical features, investigation, treatment, and the mainstay of treatment is surgery, and in most of the cases it is a modified radical mastoidectomy. So this, you have to study this, because cholesteatoma is an important topic both for theory and your clinical practice. Okay, thank you.